Be in the house of the Lord. Amen. 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 Good to see each one of you. It's good to be back. We want to say we thank Mandy for taking care of last week. Let's give her a hand for the word she brought. Amen. What a blessing it is to have capable people of handling the word of God. And as she expressed, it is a process. And in regards to that process, I'd like to ask her to stand and pray over the remainder of the service. and the word, and pray for those that have been impacted by the storm and for our state as a whole.
Father, that we would open our ears to receive the word that is being spoken today. I thank you for your willing servant to come week after week to provide fresh bread for his flock. Yeah. I thank you, Lord, for what you're doing here at Crossroads Chapel. I thank you that today would be the day that you made, and that no matter what, today we would be glad and we would rejoice in it. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Hebrews, the second chapter. Hebrews, the second chapter. We would like to begin at the beginning of that chapter and share a little bit about what the Lord's laid upon my heart. I do want to commend Sister Shelley for being obedient to the Lord in her study this morning. I felt such a confirmation from her teaching that the Lord is surely helping us every day to be inspired and to live our lives the way that He would have us live our lives. And I hope to be a blessing to you this morning, coming from this particular scripture to share what the Lord has laid upon my heart. And so we'll just go ahead and read a few verses of scripture. A lot of times I do a lot of talking before that I read the scripture. I want to read the scripture and then do a lot of talking this day. So is that okay? All right. Is that okay, Tom?
Yes.
Okay. Praise the Lord. Beginning at the first verse, therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. For if a word spoken by angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord, and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him? God bearing witness both with signs and wonders and diverse miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost according to his own will? Question mark. Praise the Lord. Skip on down to the ninth chapter. I want to get to the meat of this text. And there's going to be little things in here that I'm going to refer back to. And hopefully we'll explain some of these scriptures a little bit better so that you might understand it from the King James English to today's vernacular. So in the ninth verse, the Bible says, but we see Jesus. Amen. Who was made a little lower than the angel for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man, for it became him for whom are all things and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons unto glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For both he that sanctifieth and they who are sanctified are all one, for the which cause he is not ashamed to call them brethren, saying, I will declare thy name unto my brethren. In the midst of the church I will sing praise unto thee. And again I will put my trust in him, and again, behold, I and the children which God hath given me. Now that's a quotation of scripture, a mishmash of Isaiah and the Psalms, which were, of course, what we know to be the Old Testament. And what Paul, or the writer, was doing here was referring back to the Old Testament, saying that Jesus was speaking about the adoption of children in the New Testament according to the New Covenant, and he was explaining to these people what has happened. You'll find that in the New Testament a lot. Once the Gospels are done, some of the preachers like Stephen or Paul will say, "Let me tell you what's happened." Stephen was very pointed with his presentation. He said, "You've crucified the Lord of glory. God sent his son and you crucified him." Now, that's a rough message to receive. I don't think mine will be that rough today, but it's very similar. As I look through these scriptures, there's a lot of things that I wanted to give a little bit of expounding on. I've preached before out of the first verse, a need for heed. Many Christians live their life like there is no need to hold fast to the profession of our faith, like there's no need for heed. Well, in the Christian life, there is a need for heed. This scripture tells us that we need to give attention to what we've heard. And when it's talking about the gospel message of Jesus Christ, that we need to put our attention and our faith in the gospel and hold fast to it, because what happened in the Old Testament, it was glorious. But how much more glorious was the culmination of God's plan in the fullness of time for Jesus to come as the answer for our problems in this world? And when I say our problems, I'm talking about my problems, and I'm talking about your problems, and yes, you have problems. One problem is a sin problem. Right? It's a sin problem. Well, I have a remedy for your sin problem, and I have a remedy for my sin problem. And I'm happy to say that God gave us the gift of Jesus Christ for the remedy of our sin problem. Amen. Now, not everybody has received that gift, but I'm offering it today, and it'll be cheaper for you than a lunch ticket. Right? Amen. Amen. But then again, it'll cost you everything. Right? We do love that message. Praise the Lord. As we look at these scriptures, I wanted to get to the gifts of the Holy Ghost. I don't know if we'll get all the way there, but I wanted to talk to you about the receiving of a gift. I was able to go to a surprise birthday party while that we were away for someone who was turning 65, and I've only known this individual for a couple of years, and that at a distance. We see one another maybe once or twice a year, and I haven't really got to know him very well, and we were going to the party, and the feeling of, I wish I knew him better so that I could get him something that would be a blessing to him, that would cheer him up or let him know that he's thought about. I'm sure you can identify with that. You want to give an appropriate gift, right? Now, we do live in a world where we stop at the CVS and get a gift card, right? And sometimes we get a person-specific gift card, right? Like we might get a Dunkin' Donuts gift card if we know that the person is boycotting Starbucks, right? Right? If the person don't care, we might just grab anything, right? If we know the person is allergic to seafood, then we don't get them a Red Lobster gift card. Well, they went out of business, so I don't guess that matters anymore, does it? Listen, and what I'm talking about is a gift specific for the individual. I can remember as a child, you know how special Christmas was in my mother's side of the family. They made Christmas very special. Some of you probably put some attention on Christmas gifts, and some of you, maybe not so much. My family was split in half, right? At my grandmother's on my mother's side, we would all gather for Christmas, and there would be presents under a tree, and there would be festivities, and we would all open the presents in one another's presence, and we would enjoy the fellowship together. On the other side, on my dad's side, I might get a card with $5 if we went by there, right? On one side, I was spoiled, and on the other, I was deprived, right, of the joy of Christmas. Because let's face it, as children, the joy of Christmas is, what are you going to get for Christmas? Have you been good? It's a great question, right? And then we interject some kind of falsehood about a fat man in a red suit. I don't know. But as we gathered for Christmas this one year, and I was a young kid, I was probably 11, 12 years old, and we just playing football outside, and some of the other children had football helmets, and I wanted made a list and wanted a football helmet, and so there was a box there the size of a football helmet, and I remember the anticipation of opening that gift, and then when I got that gift out, it was a football helmet, but it was a Cardinals football helmet. Thank you, Chris. Thank you, Chris. My mother didn't know. She knew I wanted a football helmet, but she didn't know the distinction. It would be like buying Chris a Georgia helmet. Right? Or a Vanderbilt helmet. I don't know. You know, it would be like, you know what I'm talking about, right? I can remember, for my wife, I like to buy her things, win her affection. I like to buy her things to bless her. But in the process of time, bought various pieces of jewelry. Some I liked. Well, her. Oh, that's nice. But I don't really like emeralds. Right? Not that she's spoiled. She just don't like emeralds. She likes garnets. Right? Yeah. And oh, good job, she says. Why? Because I've got to know her better. What I'm driving at is my desire to know someone better so that I could get them something appropriate is what I really want to drive into full force today, because God knows you better than you know yourself. Before you even knew that you were, He was. And He is, and He will be. And so when we think about this whole thing, while you were being pieced together in your mother's womb by the Savior, He was already designed to be your Savior. He knew what you would need before you knew you needed it. In essence, He knows you better than your mother or your father. He knows you better than any friend. We're happy to have Mary back with us, and Bucky and Hannah was able to join her on a vacation overseas, and Bucky bought me a little trinket, and it was so appropriate because he gave it to me this morning, and it was something that I collect because my high school was the Vikings, and so I started collecting little Vikings. It brings me back to a place where that I have a little bit of novelty, and he brought me this little red-bearded Viking. It's only about this tall, but it meant more to me than if he would have got me, you know, gold or silver, because that's not really what my thing is, right? And so, and he did that because he knew me, right? Now I could say, and I could stretch a message out to say, how well do you know one another to, you know, but evil people
know how to give gifts to people that love them, and you know it's reciprocal. Oh, I'm gonna get you something. You can get me something. And a lot of times we give to get, right? I don't want to drive there though. What I want to drive at is how well God knows you. Right? And the gifts that He's given us as the church, how well that God knows us, each one individualistically, to the point where He knows what you need right now. He knows if you're hurting or if you're full of joy. He knows whether you're running on half empty or you're overflowing. God knows. He knows this very morning. He knows what you're going through, and He is the remedy for whatever it is, because He's a father to the fatherless, right? He's a husband to the widow, right? He's a healer to the sick. He is a savior to the sinner. Amen. God knows exactly what you need because He knows you. Amen. And I'll tell you why He knows you so well is He made you. How can the clay say to the potter, "Why have you made me thus?" It can't. Can a leopard change his spots? No. But praise the Lord, He made us to be like Him. Now what we do is we distort the image of God and what He's created us to be by making mistakes and going headlong into directions that we think that we ought to do, and some things that we know we ought not to do, we do anyway and expect a different end than what the way of all flesh is, where the truth is, if you sow to the flesh of the flesh, you'll reap corruption. I looked at this, and God, as our Creator, the gift that He's given us is life. Right? He breathed His breath into our lungs and made us a living soul. What else in creation has that blessing that God gave us who were created in His image, right? And as we were created in His image, He looked and then He breathed the breath of life as a gift, and we rose up on our feet and we walk and we talk and we can do and we can function, and He's given us the will to do it, except there is His will that doesn't always jive with our will. And so we as a people need to surrender our will to His will, that His will would be done right here on earth as it is in heaven. And when you believe God, what happens is you begin to understand and you begin to know what He likes and what He don't like. And I'll tell you some of the things that He likes. He likes an open book for a life. He doesn't like secret things. And really, there is no secret thing. The truth of God's word is the eyes of the Lord are in every place, beholding both the evil and the good. And He knows the difference, even when we don't. Right? So even in the back corridors of your thought processes, when there is something that is just eating at you, God knows that already. And He says to you, "Cast those cares on me, because I know you. I know what you're going through, and I'm able to bear you up so you don't have to stump your toe on the rocks." Life is full of rocks. Right? Now listen, as this scripture, I wanted to point out the fact that there was a little phrase in here that confuses a lot of people. When I talk about Jesus, I want my theology to be as perfect as it possibly can be, right? And what I believe from my interpretation of the scripture is that we serve a God that expresses Himself in three threefold nature. And what I mean by that is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now, a lot of people get all gummed up on this, and they think somehow that Jesus was created, but Jesus was not created. He is the Creator, and by Him, there's nothing that exists, there's nothing that lives except by Him. And all things that were created and designed to bring Him glory. The trees know it. The rocks know it. The waters know it. The clouds know it. The sun knows it. The stars know it. You should know it too. And what I want you to do is I want you to know Him a little bit better, right? And so when Jesus expresses Himself, what got Him crucified is the I am parts of His statement. The I am parts of His statement got Him crucified because what the church of the day did is they said, well, He's making Himself equal with God. And He got smart with them. And He said, well, doesn't the psalm say ye are gods? Well, they couldn't do nothing with that because that was the Old Testament. Well, an understanding of who Jesus is will open up the Old Testament in ways that you never thought were possible. You may have thought it was just the begats of who had who, but it's telling you a story of why who made who and who made who. Right? The whole thing is pointing to Jesus. It said, and Jesus would tell him, he'd say, you search the Scriptures, and in them you think you have eternal life, but they are those which testify of me. Amen. Now, I got to, I think it's the 9th chapter of Luke, last time that I was here speaking, and I was talking about how that we are all designed to be children of God, but we are not all children of God. Why? Because some of you have yet to be adopted. Now, maybe I'm preaching to the internet. Maybe all of you have, and some of them have not. Now, listen, I want you to think about this. I want you to think about a child in the foster care system. And the older they get, the harder it is for them to be placed, right? Right? But I want you to think about the joy of a child who finds their forever family. And the reason I want you to think about that is because you can understand that joy. Well, I'm telling you, God desires for you to be brothers and sisters with Him. And He wasn't, the Scripture says, He's not ashamed to call you a brother, because that's the design of the gospel in its entirety, is to adopt into the family of God those who would believe. Amen. And so if you have not believed, and if you have not taken that step of faith, I want to tell you that it's available. This gift is available. All you have to do is open it up. Some people might call it salvation, accepting the Lord. The world might call it finding religion, or he got religion. I heard that a lot. Oh, he's a Bible thumper now. Say what you will, but I found the one. I have found the Messiah. I come and see. Taste and see. I'll tell you, I'm convinced. I'm not only convinced, I'm encouraged. Amen. I'm not only encouraged, I'm on fire. Amen. And the gospel of Jesus Christ has consumed me to the point where that I am on fire for Jesus. Amen. Amen. And I'll tell you this, you can be too, because if you know Him like I know Him, He'll do what He's done for me for you. Amen. Because who here can't be saved? There's nobody here that can't be adopted into the family of God by Jesus Christ. The design of God is for you to be saved. It's not His will that any should perish. And so if you're listening to me, it is not God's will for you to remain a part of the devil's family. But it's a design of God for you to be brought into the fold. I wanted to get to that scripture because the children of Abraham in the flesh were struggling with Jesus, with his truth. They didn't know what to do with him. He raised the dead. He healed the sick. And they wanted to put him to death because he threatened their position in the church. How would you like to be responsible for all the ministry in the church and then somebody come up and say, you're not doing this according to the will of God? How would you like to have somebody come up to you and say, hey, you're tithing of mint and anise, but you're omitting the things that matter most? You don't know how to love one another. How would you like for somebody to come up to you and say, hey, listen, you'll go all the way around the world to make a disciple, and when you've made one disciple, you've made them twofold the child of hell that you are. Talk about religion. That's what we're talking about. And what happened was they got mad at Jesus, and they said, we're Abraham's seed. You know, it's so funny. We're so willing to accept things of the flesh. We use little terminologies like he's a chip off the old block. Or describing a child of a father or a mother will say things like, well, the apple doesn't fall far from the tree. Right? And what we're doing is we're describing behavior that the mother had or behavior that the father had that's passed on down to the children. And we accept that in the flesh as a resignation of who we are. Well, I want to give you hope because your heavenly Father has better plans for you than this world has for you. And just because your father was an alcoholic does not mean that you're going to be an alcoholic or have to stay one if you bought it in the first place. You can be free because who the Son has set free is free indeed. Amen. Amen. Now I'd preach if you'd let me. Praise the Lord. I want to tell you, I believe in the power of God to salvation. Amen. We so readily accept things that are passed down in the flesh through genetics or and not just the physical things, but also the perilous sinful things. If someone is abused, they're more likely to be an abuser. You know, some of the Pentecostal church has termed some of this stuff generational curses, right? And what it means is there was a spiritual something working in your mother, and it's in that house, and when you're born into that house, that generational curse tries to grab hold of you. Well, there's some truth to that, and there's some things that need to be heard, and what needs to be heard is that the blood of Christ through the anointing breaks every yoke of bondage, and I'm telling you, if Jesus sets you free, then you're free! That if death could not hold him, I'm going to tell you there's nothing that can hold you. You're supposed to be free. You're supposed to be free. And what this is the, whether you call it a generational curse or a predisposition. Because if your father cursed, then you are more likely to pick that up as a habit. As a matter of fact, that was one of the things that had me contemplating turning my life over to Christ, is because that baby right there my firstborn child was learning tricks of how to fetch daddy a beer out of the refrigerator. Because I was too lazy to get up and get it myself. Right? I spoke to you the other day about this globe that my grandfather gave me, and I had that globe out, and I was trying to educate my daughter while in the background the predispositions of what I had bought hook, line, and sinker were operating, teaching her things by my actions that I didn't even realize was happening. And we were spinning that globe, and I was showing Josie that globe, and she saw Greenland, and she said, what the is that? You talk about conviction. conviction hit me because I realized that I was leading my own child down the path of destruction. And I'll tell you, it checked me, and I pumped the brakes. And not long after, just a few days, I had surrendered my all to the Lord because I did not want to be responsible for passing down whatever it was that the devil sold me or whatever it was that I bought. I wanted my children to be free. And God wants His children to be free as well. Amen. He wants you to be free. Yeah. Right. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
That's right.
The gift of life and the gift of eternal life. And the two are different. I broached the subject of, it says Jesus was made a little lower than the angels. Well, what this means is He decreased His authority per se. And what I'm, please, you know, when you say this, people say, oh, Jesus always did. No, listen, I'm telling you, you can't kill Jesus, right? You can't defile Jesus, right? Not even the devil. Now, angels, they're in God's purview as eternal creatures. They've already crossed over into the realm because they were created to be eternal creatures, right? But so that Jesus could suffer death of the cross for you, so He could taste death and taste suffering, which you taste. Every one of you will taste. Made, He decreased to become like us. And there's a very, you know, there's a very a grand theological argument that goes on. Was Jesus 100% man, or was He 100% God? Or was He 50-50? You know, there's all this. But you can't understand spiritual things unless the Spirit of God dwells in you, and then you began to get a grip on it. And what I want to explain is, imagine that your children were in bondage, and the only way that you could deliver them was to get a message across that you wanted them to be saved and you wanted them to be free. And what that took was you going. But I'm telling you, this world and creation cannot handle the presence of the Almighty God. Now, I want you to understand, our God is a consuming fire. And when... So, God, in essence, gauges Himself in a way that we can handle it. Why? Because no flesh can glory in His presence, right? And so you get little glimpses of it when Moses went up to the mountain, and what he did, he got into the presence of God. And when he came down that mountain, his face shined because he had been in the presence of God. Right now, and when I say the presence of God, it wasn't the full-fledged presence of God, because if God were to pull back the curtain, everything is burnt up like one day will be. If you read the last chapter of Malachi, the Bible says, behold, the day will come that burns as an oven, and all that do wickedly will be as stubble under the feet of the righteous. Well, that tells me one thing. I want to be righteous.
Amen.
Amen. Right? And here's the rainbow. Oh, it's all good. You know, I'll never destroy the earth again with water. But when I pull back the curtain of eternity, the fire of God is going to purge this earth in no uncertain terms. And I'll tell you, all that do wickedly will be as stubble under the feet of the righteous. And so you better pick a side, and you better pick it soon. You better pick a family, and you better pick it soon. Right? And so I choose Jesus.
Yeah.
I choose Jesus because Jesus chose me. He chose me. Somebody said, well, are you called or are you chosen? Both. Praise God. Why? Because the church is those called out, and He chose us above all creation to put His breath inside so that we could be living souls. Now, what you do with that soul, it's your will. Some people will lose their souls. It's a terrible thing. God don't want it. But the mistakes we made, and sometimes it's our Father's fault. Sometimes it's our mother's fault. Sometimes it's our friend's fault, or our situation or circumstances' fault. You know what I mean? Because there are many devices that are aimed at overthrowing your faith, so that in this life you won't find what you need to live and live life more abundantly. And I was a little hesitant to share this because life in Christ includes suffering. There wasn't a lot of praise-alleluias there, Chris. Yeah. I say, let's all go down to the whipping post. Yeah. It's not a message. It's not a message that people want to hear. They want to hear a message about rainbows. But I'm going to talk to you about fire. Right. These children of Abraham, as you call it, they looked at Jesus with disdain and like, who are you? Who are you? And that's the same thing that the world is selling you. Yep. Who do you think you are? Who do you think you are? Your dad was like this, you're going to be like this. Your mother was like this, your people was like this, you're going to be like this. And they looked at Jesus with disdain and they said, who do you think you are? We're Abraham's children. And Jesus looked at them and said, if you were Abraham's children, then you would know me. Because Abraham rejoiced to see my day. You're only 30 years old. How do you say Abraham? See, they didn't know Jesus. They thought he was from Nazareth. Right? Some of them said, no prophet comes out of Nazareth, because they had been studying the scripture. But Jesus wasn't born in Nazareth. But if you get to know Jesus a little bit better, oh, Bethlehem. Come on now. Oh, little town of Bethlehem. Though you might be, that's why the scripture says, don't despise small beginnings. Not everybody knows about it, but Jesus was born in Bethlehem. They didn't know it then. They thought he was from Nazareth, because that's who his earthly father was. They thought he was the son of a carpenter. That's who his earthly father was. But I'm telling you what, his earthly father didn't matter, because he was one with his heavenly father. And he knew what it meant to be one with his heavenly father. And he spoke about his heavenly father as if he were one. He said, I don't speak of myself. Whatever I hear, I speak. That would scare you all to death. Right? And I want to tell you, it scares the world to death. Because then they have to take an account. Am I Abraham's seed? Am I what my father or my mother was? Or am I a child of God? And you know what? We understand now why Jesus said, I've come to set a mother against her daughter-in-law. Right? Or the members of your house will be an enemy. Or unless you hate your mother and father, and when they use that terminology, we lose our mind. Right? But I'm going to tell you, if your mother and your father would take you to hell, Jesus has a remedy for that. And unless you hate their way and love His, then you're going to be lost right along with them. But I'm here standing as a road sign on life that Jesus still saves and He still sanctifies. And I love this scripture. It says, He that sanctifies and those that are sanctified are one.
Yes.
Those. And what we do is we say, well, that's the way that my family's always been. You need to be a cycle breaker.
Yes.
Right? You need to put your foot down and now proclaim, as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. And whatever that looks like and whatever that means for you, God knows what you need and He knows what it looks like because He knows you better than you know yourself.
Right.
Amen. Well, we accept the faults of our earthly fathers so readily, and we say, well, that's just the way that I am. When I want to tell you, you have a holy father, and he sets an example for you of holiness. And what I want to do is tell you that those attributes are designed for you. There was a song that was penned a while back that, and you may or may not have heard it because it didn't get a lot of play now, but it used to then. It's because he has his father's eyes, right? And it was a Christian song, and it was talking about an individual who could see the world like Jesus did, could feel and have compassion on the world. And it was talking about an individual. And I want you to come with me here, because to believe Jesus, we must believe that we need to be saved from something. You know, you don't have to drive to lunch, so give me 5 more minutes, all right? But salvation is not the end-all, be-all. God's design is that you be sanctified and set apart for His work. God's design is that you be filled and flowing with all the gifts that God has designed for the church. The same Spirit, a diversity of gifts. And I don't know specifically, you know, I know some of you, and I might know how to get you something that would tickle your fancy, but God knows exactly what you need even today. Can you say amen? Amen. Amen. I wanted to talk about our spiritual father and how that we have been given an opportunity to know Him better. If you turn with me to John, the 4th chapter, one last verse of Scripture that I'll share with you. It's a familiar story about the woman at the well. And Jesus was there waiting for the woman. And in the 10th verse, Jesus said, "If you knew the gift of God," these words are written in red, Jesus speaking, "if you knew the gift of God and who it is that saith to thee, 'Give me to drink,' thou would have asked of Him and He would have given thee living water." Okay, so this woman is used to coming doing the same old thing. She had a troubled life. I think it was 5 husbands. Any woman would probably say that's a troubled life. Right? Right? Either that or her picker was broken. I don't know. But Jesus said, if you knew who it was that was talking to you, you would have asked of Him and He would give to you. Because I'm telling you, Jesus knew her problems, and offered her salvation anyway. And I'm going to tell you, you may be saved today and you may have accepted the Lord, but I'm telling you there's so much more. And what my design is to flow in the Spirit to the point that I used my gifts to be an example of being like Jesus. And rather than accepting the cursing, I want you to accept the blessing. And the blessing is this, that God created us to be like Jesus. We struggle at the truth of the scripture that says, be ye perfect as I am perfect. And we do all kind of gymnastics to say, well, nobody's perfect, or oh, we'll never make that, oh, we're all just flesh. Let me tell you, that's not God's design. God's design is for you to dive in as a living sacrifice, and then He'll supply everything that you need to do it right. We so readily accept the sins of the Father. I want you to be just as ready or even more ready to accept the holiness of a living God. I want you to accept your destiny of who you were created to be. And that is a mouthpiece or an ear or an eye or the feet or the hands of the actual body of Christ. Amen. Don't tell me you can't do it. Don't tell me nobody's perfect. You know, and what we do, we say, well, that word really means complete. Okay. I'm happy for you to be complete in Christ Jesus. And so many people in churches all over the world, have settled for land on this side of the river, when the promised land is on the other. Now you might have to take a step of faith, and you might have to reach out and grab, and you might have to suffer, and you might have to go through some things, but I'm telling you, He will be with you all the way. Amen. Would you stand with me? Wow. In the giving of Himself, He has given us a down payment, and He has paid our ransom. In the giving of Himself, He has secured our salvation, our sanctification, and our filling and our flowing. Holiness of the Father. Would you bow your heads with me? Heavenly Father, we love You today. We thank You for this opportunity, Lord, to be together. Lord, I pray that the truth of Your word will saturate each mind and each heart to the point where that the hunger and the thirst for righteousness will be tangible in their life, and they will not be satisfied with anything less than Your holiness in their own life. And I pray that our church walks in the truth of Your word and in the beauty of holiness. And I ask You to bless the food. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Shake somebody's hand. Let them know you love them today. I appreciate you. I appreciate you being here. Be sure to stay for our spaghetti dinner.